This is a painting of Robert Hooke, a mathematician who lived from 1635 to 1703. That's more than 300 years ago. You would expect this portrait to be painted during his lifetime, you know, when he was still alive. But this painting was actually completed in 2004, 300 years after his death. Why? Well, it is thought that the only portrait of Hooke was destroyed, and the person responsible for that was probably Newton. Hooke was one of the most brilliant scientists in 17th century England, but we have no surviving paintings of him, perhaps due to Newton's feud with him. It started when Hooke wanted to take on Newton. In the early 1670s, Hooke proposed the idea that planets were held in place by a force inversely proportional to their distance from the sun, and he wrote to Newton about it. Apparently, Newton had the same idea. While Hooke couldn't provide proof for his idea, Newton was able to provide quantitative mathematical support for Hooke's hypothesis. This led him to publish his Principia, which presented his idea on the laws of motion and universal gravitation in 1687. The journey to publishing this work, however, wasn't smooth sailing. A year before, when the manuscript made its first appearance at a meeting of the Royal Society in 1686, Hooke, also stubborn like Newton, had a lot to say. He stated that he discovered the law and wanted credit for the idea. This obviously angered Newton. He responded by claiming that it was Hooke who stole this idea through letters Newton sent to Huygens. The war of words became increasingly bitter when they argued over color and the nature of light. Their nasty quarrel eventually got to Newton. When Hooke died in 1703 due to health reasons, Newton became the president of the Royal Society, and it is assumed that one of his first acts was to destroy the only portrait of Hooke. Not only that, he removed Hooke's archived papers and research from the society. Fortunately, most of it was eventually recovered. There's no doubt that Newton was a genius. He conceived the theory of gravity, built the first usable reflecting telescope, and created a new form of mathematics, which is calculus. He was deeply engaged in his experiments and was willing to put himself at risk. For example, he used himself as a guinea pig when he wanted to study color and vision. One time, he placed a blunt needle or a bodkin under his eyelid and moved his eye around using the bodkin. It produced odd circles of colors and other images. He also stared at the sun reflected in a mirror for as long as he could. When he looked away at a wall, he saw concentric circles of light and color he called motion of spirits. His peculiar fascination with blinding himself eventually enabled him to publish another influential work, Optics. However, despite his brilliance, or perhaps even because of it, he was very bitter, egoistic, vengeful, and conniving. He argued with almost everyone in the scientific community of the time. He got into a fight with Gottfried Leibniz over who first invented calculus when Leibniz published his work on calculus in 1684. He turned on Huygens when they argued about the nature of light. Newton thought that light consists of particles, while Huygens thought that light is made of waves. He also argued with John Flamsteed over the excess of the telescope and many others who were unlucky enough to have crossed paths with him. He even accused his friend Pepys of speaking ill of him and broke off their correspondence, though he later apologized. Newton couldn't seem to stand to be criticized by anyone, neither friend nor foe. He also committed transgressions and kept a list. When he was in his 20s, he kept a diary of the sins he had committed. In fact, he listed 57 of them. Some of the list includes making pies on Sunday, stealing plums and sugar from his mother, setting his heart on money, gluttony, beating Arthur Storer, punching his sister, and threatening to burn the house down around his mother and stepfather. As you can see, he had some issues with himself, but he was aware enough to know that it was bad. Due to that, Newton felt like he was a great sinner. There was no excuse for Newton's behavior, but it's not fair to only blame Newton. Most people Newton ever quarreled with were not innocent. They were pretty stubborn too. When Newton presented his reflecting telescope to the Royal Society, he was accused of plagiarizing the telescope of James Gregory. when he submitted his paper on the nature of light, it was heavily criticized by the community, and the criticism was led by none other than Robert Hooke himself. It was so rancorous that Newton withdrew his publication and only published it 30 years later, after Hooke's death. Then, when Newton was completing his work on gravity, Principia, Hooke claimed that Newton plagiarized him, claiming sole credit for the discovery of gravity. It's for these reasons that many think Newton destroyed Hooke's painting. After all, he had the motive and capacity to do so. But it's worth noting that there's no evidence that can back up the claim, and the portrait of Hooke may not even exist to begin with, so the theory can be considered a myth. As for the dispute with Flamsteed, Flamsteed refused to give Newton access to data from his astronomical observations because it was incomplete and because of differing philosophies on how data should be analyzed. So, Newton used his influence and played dirty to get the data. What's more, he got the data published by the person Flamsteed hated most, Halley. So, while Flamsteed was certainly no angel, more of that blame can be pointed to Newton. Leibniz was probably the least hostile rival discussed here when he fell victim to Newton's vengeful actions in their calculus dispute. However, he's also not entirely blameless. It was very legitimate for Leibniz to criticize Newton, but his attack turned personal when he couldn't fault the mathematics of Newton's theory, so he attacked Newton's religion instead. Now, Newton was very religious and even believed that he was chosen by God to uncover the secrets of the universe. He was very aware of the possible dangers to religious beliefs of his theory, and being made fun of didn't exactly amuse him. Still, there's no excuse for Newton's despicable behavior. But you have to keep in mind that he had to deal with opponents whose behavior was often not better than his, and at times, worse. Basically, the late 17th century scientific community was filled with grumpy old men behaving badly. Like many people, Newton's troubled personality originated from his childhood. He was born a sickly child and was not expected to live. His father died a few months before his birth. 3 years later, his mother remarried and he was left to his grandmother at the age of 3. Because of this, young Newton felt abandoned. In his diary, Newton noted, "What shall become of me? I will make an end of it. I can only weep. I do not know what to do." During Albert Einstein's final interview, he talked a lot about Newton. When asked about Newton's refusal to acknowledge Hooke's ideas, Einstein stated that Newton's behavior, sadly, is vanity. It's often found in scientists, and it always hurt him that Galileo didn't acknowledge Kepler's work. To Einstein, many of us are childish, some are more childish than others. However, if a man knows he is childish, that knowledge can be a mitigating factor. Perhaps, deep down, the adult Newton was still just an insecure, self-absorbed child, dependent on lifelong academic research to preserve his sanity and the sense of security. Thank you.